Coming to us from Pensacola, Florida, to discuss the latest on these scandals is Mike Papantonio. He's co-host of Ring of Fire, a nationally syndicated radio show. Mike, as always, welcome back inside the war room.
Mike, how are you?
I'm well. There's so much to talk about. I mean, they keep giving us stuff in Washington. I'm really glad you're on to talk about this today. Shouldn't the Senate be bemoaning the laws that they wrote rather than excoriating the CEO of a company that is living within those laws?
Yeah, well, both things should be happening. Rand Paul should be embarrassed, for example, that ever since the Mitt Romney candidacy, we had the media going crazy about offshore banks. And everybody was concerned. They feigned concern. You had people in the Beltway feigning concern. But since then, Mike, there has been zero done by these windbags up in Washington that are making such an issue out of this. Look, we ought to figure out why 50 of the world's largest private banks in the world have increased their offshore business holdings from $5 trillion since 2005 to almost $15 trillion in 2011. It's a system that's rampant, not with tax avoidance, but with tax fraud, when it really comes down to it. Now, the Apple situation, yes, they did comply with the law. If you ask Tim Cook, though, you know, Tim, how do you get your product delivered? Do you use our roads? Do you use our military to protect your business interests? Do you use our police officers? Tim won't talk about the infrastructure that we pay in America. And the Congress, they won't talk about the fact that we lose $100 billion a year to offshore bank schemes like the one we're talking about. The truth is, this is such a big issue that you had UBS, you may recall, UBS, we found this list of people of all types, corporate types, hiding money offshore. They wouldn't disclose the list. They made UBS pay this huge fine, but nobody went to jail. There was obviously criminal conduct involved, but yet our Senate, our House, does nothing to change these laws.
Wow, who would have thought that the Congress would make a bank pay a huge fine, but nobody goes to jail? That must be the first time that's ever happened. But let's look at the politics for a second, Mike. Does Rand Paul win by applauding Tim Cook and Apple here? What's his strategy there?
Well, he wins the quick conversation because he's a great demagogue. I mean, he always has those great one-liners that any great demagogue has. But when you examine what Tim Cook has to say, and you really start saying, well, part of the process, Apple, is America has given you the opportunity to do what you've been able to do, to be so successful. And when I hear these corporations say, you know, gee whiz, we complied with law, we did everything we were supposed to do, I promise you this, Mike, if you took a look at the effort that a Tim Cook type has done to make sure that the offshore banking laws don't change by putting huge amounts of money into the lobby effort, you would see he was one of those corporations, just like Exxon, just like Goldman Sachs, just like all the Wall Streeters who don't want to pay their fair share.
Yeah, and that's, again, another great point, Mike. I mean, you should look at what he's done to help create and keep those lawmakers in office to help create this kind of atmosphere where he's able to dodge all of these taxes for his company legally. But still, that's the problem, is that it is legal, not that he broke the law.
Yes.
Let's move from that part of the IRS to the IRS that's been knocking at the White House door. Jay Carney said that he didn't know about the IRS targeting conservative groups, and neither did the president. I actually don't believe that Benghazi was a cover-up. With Lois Lerner taking the fifth tomorrow, might this be the actual cover-up at the White House?
Well, I don't see this. I don't see this as the cover-up that's as bad as the cover-up that we're going to see with the AP story. I think, frankly, when it comes right down to it, I think Wyden had it correct, and that is we saw all these Tea Party types coming in asking for special handling, special dispensation under 501c3. At the same time, they were saying that we were not political organizations. We don't have a political agenda, which is a requirement for 501c3. They were out in the streets holding up damn signs of Obama depicted as a Nazi war criminal and as a monkey. Now, that sounds pretty political to me. So for the IRS to be there defending themselves rather than aggressively saying, you know what, we were doing our job. We were doing exactly what we're supposed to do, and that's to protect these thugs from coming in and stealing taxpayer money by calling themselves some 501c3 corporate type that's entitled to special protection.
Yeah, and that goes without saying. I mean, you know, when there's, they say that they're social welfare groups, and there was nothing for the welfare of our society in what they were doing. So I think they have to look at, I think it was the C4s, I think they have to look at those C4s again and figure out a way around
what they've been doing.
Yeah, I mean, who can keep track of it anyway? So, let's go to the AP story that you're talking about. There have been a lot of calls for Attorney General Eric Holder to resign, many of them coming from the left. Is this a good idea or is it too reactionary?
He should step down immediately. Listen, this guy has a very bad history, not just on this story, Michael. If you take a look at this man's history, this is a guy who actually infiltrated the Occupy movement to try to find out if he could find anything on them rather than doing what he should have done, going after Wall Street. He infiltrated the environmental activist movement because he was concerned that they were complaining about things like global warming, for God's sakes, or the XL pipeline. This guy has had a terrible track record. At the same time that he was ignoring Wall Street, he was also going after whistleblowers, people who were trying to come forward and say, you know what, there's some awful things that our government is doing and we need to do something about it. Now, rather than listening to their story, he prosecuted them. He prosecuted six people under the 1917 Espionage Act, more people than had been prosecuted in the entire history of the presidency. At the same time he was doing that, he was covering up for his pals on Wall Street, not issuing any subpoenas, not engaging in any kind of wiretaps, not doing any investigation that was meaningful, because he was a product of Covington Burling. And Covington Burling represented all these folks on Wall Street. But nevertheless, he could go after Aaron Schwartz. He could go after athletes who were doping. He could go after medical marijuana growers. And so this guy has been a disaster for this president. And the real question in my mind is, did the president intentionally want those types of policies? I can only conclude that that's what Obama wanted.
Yeah, that's why
he's still there.
It would seem like the evidence has proven that that's exactly what he wanted, even though on paper I wouldn't think he would want those things. But if you ever want an argument for why Eric Holder should be done at the Justice Department, give Mike Papantonio a call.